All right, we have a slideshow here. This was that Sunday that we talked about last Sunday, doing some of the cleanup. We had a lot of great volunteers. I'm grateful for everybody who put in the effort to get us ready for the first day. Managed to get the walls all done. And Lyle helped finish that this week. And on our first day of school, we had some visitors. And we're grateful for Betty and her help getting our boards, our bulletin boards up and running and making sure all those kids feel included and special. And they came rolling in. There's Nathalia helping. She was there, helping her siblings, and Anna in the background there, helping her siblings, getting stuff in their lockers. And then we went on our walk. Then we have our first group worship together. We had a lot of, there's Owen raising his hand. He had a lot of questions on that first day and also some statements. So it was fun. It was fun having the kids be interested in what I was saying. That was good. And I clicked next, but it didn't go. There we go. All right, we have you guys might remember this song. Mr. Coffee shared it with us, and we're using it as our theme song this year. And it's that passage from Steps to Christ. And here's my room, 5th through 8th grade this year, and then K-4 room. Get to go on a boat trip. Just need a little bit more water. But I guess the imagination is a powerful thing. So you can see here our students all getting their little time in the sun, their spotlight shining on them, their birthdays and how old they are. And they got to, this was yesterday, getting to play outside. Here's Owen getting a wind up for a kick. Oh, that's a little backwards. The ball comes this way, and then he comes for a kick. And then, we don't see where it went. Anyways, let's see. This was also yesterday, the kids working on a Bible assignment where they had to recite some things that they knew, working together, sharing ideas. And we are really fortunate to have the kids help us with the fish tank. In a couple weeks, we're going to be putting in some new fish that are from a local lake. So we have a permit to keep some little local game fish like bluegill and perch and that kind of stuff. So if we can get some varieties of species, we'll have those in our fish tank. So thank you so much for the attention, as I talked about this. For those of you who happen to have a fishing pole for that trip, come see me, because we would be happy to borrow that. Between the Garings and myself, we might have about 5 poles or so. And we've got 10 students who are going to be out trying to collect some specimens. So if you have some fishing poles that we could borrow, we'd be much appreciative of that. And then also just remember that tomorrow at 3 o'clock is our school and men's ministry kind of get together. And so you are all invited to that. And there will be softball game and food and bouncy houses and a dunk tank. So a lot of fun. So if you're interested in inviting someone, feel free to do that. The local firefighters have been invited to come, and they're going to be supplying at least the dunk tank. So if you know of somebody else who has kids who would enjoy that, we would be happy to see them. And there's no fee. It's just supported by men's ministry. And so if you're able to help at all with that, with running some things, you probably could see Lyle. He would appreciate hearing from you. So thank you so much, and have a great rest of your Sabbath.
Chad, I would make sure that the fish you put in the tank aren't too big, or Tom's going to be over there fishing them out for you. Just a thought. Good morning, everybody. I'd like you to turn to those who are around you and give them a big smile. Smiling does not pass COVID. You can smile all you want, and no one will ever catch COVID from that. Have a reminder from Betty. There is a poster board out in the lobby on the table, and she is asking that everybody, all ages, please sign the poster board in the foyer to thank the firefighters for their service, and we will be presenting that to them sometime tomorrow then, Betty. And we expect to see it posted on the door of the firehouse. Maybe, maybe not. I'd like to add my thanks to those who came and worked so hard last Sunday at the school, in the school, outside of the school, made a big difference. And I think Chad has already covered that we got the sale coming up next Sunday. Tom, I was thinking that was tomorrow, and I was totally forget what I said about the irises. That's maybe next week. When we are looking ahead to our calendar, we need to make sure that our schedules are cleared out for the time for the evangelistic meetings, so we can concentrate, so we can participate and support that. And hopefully, we will be blessed no matter what happens by God, but we want to make sure that we're inviting people that we know too. And we'll be talking about more of that over the next few Sabbaths. Are there any other announcements? Anyone else have anything to add? We've got Pathfinders coming up. We've got the school year started. We're back in the swing of things, folks. And so glad that you are here. Lyle. Yeah.
Tomorrow's event is going to be great, and it's going to be kind of surprising. Our men's ministry leader is under the weather, so we thought maybe we could, you know, make it a women's ministry event, but our women's ministry leader is under the weather, and so that just leaves us chickens. Yeah, so we could use some help tomorrow. It's not like we need everybody at the same time, but we will be dressing 12 dozen ears of corn for eating. And so that'll probably not happen automatically. So some of you who are great, you've got a machete and you know how to use it, and you're good at that, you'd be able to help us with that. Various things are arriving in the afternoon for the fun and enjoyment of all. And the food has been purchased, so we don't have to worry about it. We just have to get it ready to eat. So you don't have to be a man to help. Men's Ministries is going to try to coordinate this, but we are not going to be sexist about this. We allow all volunteers who want to help to do that. Like I say, we don't need everybody at one. We could use a few people at two. We'd like to have people freed to play the game at 3 and maybe a few people on the sidelines cheering. I don't know. So, as you can see, we could use some help. So I'm not going to call for a meeting afterwards today. Bring what? Oh, bring your mitt, because if you're catching without a mitt, you might hurt your hands. So yeah, need to bring your own mitt. The ball is supplied. Okay, and the bat. We have a few mitts, but if you're a lefty, we may not have the right one for you. Better bring your own. And so whatever. So anyhow, that's what's going on tomorrow. We're looking forward to it. And if you see your way clear, come a little bit early and we'll find something that you can do to help out. Thank you very much. And don't forget, today after church, you need to find this little table in the lobby and sign your name if you appreciate what the firefighters are doing in our area to keep us safe. Betty? Maybe even bring an extra for somebody who forgets. Yeah. So that would be nice. That would be good. Anything else? Okay. All right. Thank you, Dave.
All right. I guess we are ready to do some singing. So our praise team, and we're very, very glad our praise team is all here safely today. There's a story behind that, but I'll let her tell.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Mr. Rasmussen started sharing how grateful we are to see Nathalia today. Many of you heard the one call that came through yesterday requesting prayers for this dear young lady. There was a scary situation that took place in South Haven yesterday out on the pier. But thankfully, Nathalia, even though she was working in South Haven, was far away from that incident. But as every mama out in the congregation knows, when something scary is going on near your child, your heart just asks for prayer from all those who are willing. So those of you that received that call and prayed, we're very grateful. And Nathalia's favorite song is Amazing Grace. So we're going to turn this morning to 108 and begin together with Amazing Grace. We will sing the first and the third.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see.
Verse 3.
The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secure. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures.
Amen. And how grateful we are that He is our shield. The next song is 612, Onward Christian Soldiers. And as we sat here this morning watching the special feature that Mr. Higgins shared, we're reminded that our most precious mission field is right across the way at our church school. And those are the dear soldiers that are being prepared for Christ's kingdom. And so we lift the teachers and each student up in prayer daily, and we thank you for your prayers as well. 612, Onward Christian Soldiers, and we will sing the first and second.
Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. Christ the royal master leads against the foe, forward into battle. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war.
second verse?
Like a mighty army moves the church of God. Christians, we are trodden where the saints have trod. We are not divided, all one body bring, one in hope and doctrine, one in charity. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before.
And if you've ever been at the school in the morning watching those doors swing open when it's time for the day to begin, those precious little feet look like a mighty army for Jesus. All right. As we turn our minds to the theme for the sermon today, we're going to turn to page 92. This is My Father's World, 92. And we're going to sing all verses.
Is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world, my rest in the thought, the rocks and trees, the skies and seas, his hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world, the birds and carols raise, the morning lights, the lily white, declares the Maker's praise. This is my Father's world. He shines in all that's there. In rustling grass I hear him pass. He speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me never forget. And oh, the wrong seems not so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world, why should my heart be sad? The Lord is King, let the heavens ring, God reigns, let the earth be glad.
You will find our theme song in the inside cover of your bulletin, and it is number 668 in your hymn book. And we will stand together as we sing.
Call to worship this morning is in Psalms 19, and we'll read verses 1 to 5. Psalm 19, 1 to 5. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Day unto day utters speech, and night unto night reveals knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he has set a tabernacle for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoices like a strong man to run its race. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word this morning.
Our opening song is on page number 2, All Creatures of Our God and King. Page number 2.
Father in heaven, Father, we invite you here today by your Holy Spirit to guide our minds and our thoughts that we will be molded and fashioned more like you want us to be. We pray for your blessing, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Our offering this morning is for church budget, and the collection box for that is in the back of the church in the foyer and area. And so we encourage you to give in that while leaving if you have not already given. The church had a roof problem. It leaked. One time the pastor counted 6 buckets in place to catch the drips. Raindrops fell on the rugs, pews, and tile floors. It seemed like a new leak was discovered every time it rained. The church board discussed the problem. "We don't have extra money in the budget," they agreed, "but let's at least get a few estimates so we know how much we will need." After getting several estimates to repair the roof, the board saw that the church didn't have enough resources to cover the entire expense. They had to make a choice. "Could we cover the roof with a tarp while we wait for funds?" they wondered. "Or should we take out a loan?" The pastor suggested a third option. "Let's take this matter to the congregation. Perhaps when they understand the need, they'll give extra offerings to repair the roof." Within weeks, the church had raised over 90% of the funds. The pastor and head elder agreed to move by faith and schedule the repairs. As the work went forward, the extra funds kept coming into the local church budget. Upon completion, the church had enough funds to pay the final installment of the bill. Where the body of Christ works together in unison, great things can happen. "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for the brethren to dwell together in unity." Psalm 133:1. And obviously our church does an amazing job of that. But we can thank God for giving us the spirit of unity to continue to work together for his cause with our local church. Let's bow our heads with prayer before we bless the offering. Dear Heavenly Father, you own everything. You own the cattle on 1,000 hills. You have merely made us stewards of the many, many blessings that you have poured upon us. And we pray that you would continue to give us that spirit of generosity, of willingness to give of our means, not merely for ourselves, or not looking at merely our own interests, but the interests of others and the interests of your work that is going forth to the ends of the earth, and help us to be supportive of our local church as we work in our own circle here in our local area to be a blessing to others. In your name, amen.
It's time for the children's story and for the collection of the offerings. And remember, the offerings go to help GJA. So kids, come on down and do your thing. Thank you.
Well, we need some boys and girls up here. I'm glad Elise and her cousins stuck around, because we have some questions to ask today and a lesson to learn, okay? So, girls, oh, good. Can anybody tell me what the smallest bird in Michigan is? Think of what the smallest bird in Michigan would be. That's right. I was going to give you a clue. This is what he eats out of. And I didn't want it full, so I emptied it. So there's... Okay. So I had this hanging on my deck to begin with. Can you see the holes in there? See how tiny they are? See how tiny those holes are?
Yeah.
You know what a hummingbird looks like?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yeah, it goes fast.
It goes very fast.
Yeah, and it's so tiny.
It's very tiny. I want to show you a picture real quick. His wings up and down 60 times a second.
That's
a lot of times. Can you do that with your arms? 60 times a second. I'm doing good if I can do a couple of seconds. But anyway, you know how long he is? He's only about that long. Just over 2 inches.
Maybe when we were
in
Michigan, we saw like a dead hummingbird.
Well, I had one hit my picture window, and I went out and looked at him. He was so tiny, I thought he killed himself. But you know what? I went out there and looked later, and he was flown away. But that's not part of my story. My story is about this hummingbird feeder. It was hanging on my deck, and I looked out, and there was something more on the hummingbird feeder than just the hummingbird.
It was a big bird.
What?
It was a woodpecker.
And I'm like, that's such tiny little holes, but he was just feeding his little beak with the woodpecker was feeding out of this hummingbird feeder. And I'm like, how did he get food out of there? Well, you know, there was something else that liked the syrup that was in here. Do you have an idea what that might be? It has 6 legs and it's black. Yes? No. Yes? They have eggs, yes. Okay, you know what else likes syrup out of here? Yes? That's right. An ant. And when I emptied this out to bring it, the whole bottom inside was full of dead ants. And it was pretty gross. And so, my hummingbird, I have three of them that love to buzz around my, they're fighting little birds. And I'm like, why can't you be nice? I've got 3 feeders. Why can't you each go to 1 feeder and be happy? Now, this is a hummingbird.
Is it great big or a little tiny? It's a little tiny. And can you imagine a little egg in that nest?
And Jesus made the right size, let them make the right size nest for their little birds. And so I have 2 hummingbird feeders.
And I also have,
do you know what kind of a feeder this is? What kind of bird might go to this feeder?
A
an Oreo feeder. And that's what this is. But you know what? It's an Oreo feeder. But you know what? The hummingbirds like this feeder almost better than that feeder. But something else likes this feeder too. And if you look real careful, can you see something in there? What's in there? Now, this is a hummingbird feeder. And you know what? This is like our world. Okay, did you want to see it? If the Bible tells a verse about we're supposed to be in the world, but not of the world. And if we're like the bees and we go in and out this hole, sometimes we can't get out. And that's the way when we're in the world and we decide we want to do things that we shouldn't, we kind of get trapped and don't know how to get back out. And we don't want to do that. We want to study God's word so we know how to get where we need to be, right? We don't want to get hung up in the world doing the worldly things. So we want to remember not to get trapped in the world, but do what Jesus wants and what he says. So you can go back to your seats. Thank you.
Suppose that if we just drink sugary water, we might be able to go 60 times a second. Not going to try. It's time to go.
Come together in prayer. And we have no shortage of requests and praises. Some of those are our family. We certainly praise the Lord for family, don't we? And we're a church family, right? So we praise the Lord for family, for our gardens. I'm sure we're all, those of us that are growing gardens, are starting to reap some of the rewards. Praise the Lord for the weather. This is the weather that we wish for all winter, right? Hope I didn't say that too loud. For good health, we praise the Lord for good health, right? For religious freedom, we praise the Lord. For victories, both spiritual and physical victories. We have a lot of requests. The situation in South Haven, the tragedy there. I guess there was a shooting out on the pier. That's what I'm understanding. For GJA, our school right here, we want to pray for a police officer that was died in the line of duty. We want to pray for our corn roast, for traveling mercies, for fires out west. We don't see that type of thing here so much in Michigan, but I imagine that's got to put you on pins and needles if you have a pretty good fire coming your way. Earthquake out east for Aaron Brower and his family for help in recovering the illnesses that they're dealing with. Sherilyn had surgery. I want to keep her in prayer. The mission trip for traveling mercies too with that. For our children, we want to pray for evangelistic series coming up for Natalie and her health. Jamie and Aaron, they're in quarantine. Karen Utman for awaiting results there. The nursing staffs in different hospitals there's a shortage there. We want to keep that in prayer. For people in Afghanistan, for Haiti, and the list goes on and on that we have too in each of our minds and hearts. So let's come together in prayer, shall we? Our Father in heaven, Father, we are so thankful that you are God and that you are unchanging. You are always the way that you are. We thank you that you love us so much. We thank you for Jesus that has given his life for us to ransom us from this sin-sick world. And we are in need of a Savior, and we are claiming Jesus as our Savior this morning. And Father, you've heard all our requests, all the people, all the situations, and we want to give them to you for your working, for your special way that you deal with all that you do. So we lift them to each to you and know that the outcome will be better and different than had we not. So we're thankful for what you do. Thank you for hearing our prayers. Thank you for always being available. There's no hold. There's no voicemail. Father, we're thankful that you are always. Praying for the message that's provided today, that it'll be what each one of us need, that it'll draw us closer to you as a result. And may the blessing of the Sabbath be to each one of us. So we pray for that too, that you would help each one of us to find that rest that you have for us. We thank you for the Sabbath. And Father, we just lift to you all those things on our heart yet, on our minds, that you would provide. And thank you for being the great provider. We ask, praying in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our scripture reading for today is taken from Isaiah 61, 1 through 3 and 11. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prisons to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. Verse 11, for as the earth bringeth forth her bud, and as the garden causeth all things that are sown in it to spring forth, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all the nations. May God add his blessing to our reading of his word. Thank you.
Amen. Happy Sabbath. Wow, that song was very beautiful. And it's the heart of the point of the message that I want to share with you, because this world is ugly and painful and downright cruel, but there are blessings right outside our back window and right outside our back door. And we don't have to live with fear and dread and discontentment, because there are so many promises to be experienced. So thank you very much, Randall's. That touched my heart very much. And I just feel very just blessed. Blessed by how much God loves me and God loves you. So I know most of you, as I was raised in this church, but there are some faces that I do not recognize, so I'll just do a short introduction. My name is Angie Boothby, and my mom teaches at GGA, Janelle Boothby, so there's the connection for some. And I am a teacher as well. I swore I would never be a teacher. Be careful what you say no to, because that's sometimes where God leads exactly. But I saw the long hours my mother dear puts in, and I said, nope, not a never. And then the good Lord was like, I think you should be a teacher. And I've never regretted it. I love being a teacher. So I've taught for the last 8 years, and I have my master's in outdoor education. Huh? It's okay, I get that reaction all the time. It's a real master's, and I did not play the entire time. Master's in outdoor education simply means that I was given the tools to take regular core curriculum and teach it in the outdoors. So no, I didn't get to go on awesome backpacking trips and camping trips. Nope, I looked at math and science and English, and how can we teach it using the great outdoors? And for a couple years now, I've been speaking here and there about it. At Michigan camp meeting. From there, it got put on Audioverse. From there, as you remember, I moved to Switzerland because somebody heard it on Audioverse. And God has just been opening up doors and doors. So lots of people have been wondering what I am doing this next year. And I realized it was a great shame to travel around speaking about something that I think is incredibly empowering and not share it with my family and not share it with my home church. And so I am not teaching this year. I am officially, I guess, the market director for a new curriculum. We have been praying and working on a curriculum, a little team of us, for the last couple of years. And we're trying to get gardens back in our schools. So if you see anything called acquainting agriculture, that is what I am working on. And at the same time, I'm also praying with Chris about starting an own ministry called Connect. And what we would be doing is something like this, coming to a church and sharing the benefits about being outdoors and also doing week of prayers outside and doing family retreats. So we just did a teacher training down for a village Monday and Tuesday, helping them shift the way that they're teaching to using the outdoors more in a technological pressing world. And so I'm excited to share you the message that has been life-changing and life-empowering to me. So we'll see if I have power from back here. All right, we're going to be a team. All right, so let's see. Let's do a little test. How many of you realize you have a disorder? Okay. How many of you are brave enough to admit that you might have the nature deficit disorder? Okay, so you're like, what's that? Well, let me tell you. It is a term coined by an author called Richard Louv. He wrote The Nature Principle and Last Child in the Woods, if you want to look more into. This is just a tiny bit that I'm going to share with you today, but there is much, much more out there with all sorts of great facts and case studies about the benefits of being outside. So basically, if you have the nature deficit disorder, this describes the alienation that you have from nature. So just ask yourself, how much time did you spend outside in nature this last week? Okay. Among them, the diminished use of the senses. I went on a hike with a boy from the UP years ago when I was running outdoor ed for Camp Asabo, and he's like, stop. Do you smell that? Trees, birds, what do you mean smell? He's like, that's a grouse. What? Because he had such a heightened sense of smell, because he was raised up there in the UP, he could smell a bird. Can you guys smell a bird? I can't smell a bird, all right? But I bet if you ask your grandparents stories, they can tell you about using their senses in a whole way that we don't use our senses today. All right, like for example, how many of you have really heard the birds sing or heard the wind in the trees? We just walk to our vehicles, or not even to our vehicles anymore, because we sit in garage doors, right? So most of us actually never even see the outdoors because we get into our car in the garage and then we pull out and then we go to work and we go into our office building, and that's the grand sum total of our outside time, right? And there's higher attention difficulty. So the average person, guess how long your attention span is, which really is encouraging to me this Sabbath morning? 8 seconds. So you're already done with me. You've stopped listening to me already, and it's just begun. To give you a little context of that, a goldfish is 9 seconds. Okay, so we have less of an attention span than a goldfish. That's how we're doing. Okay, we've gone progressively down in our attention span. Also, there's higher rates of physical and emotional illnesses. And working up at Great Lakes Avis Academy last year, I'm telling you, our high school kids are struggling. They talk about things we never talked about. And I'm not even that much removed. Yes, I'm older. I'm very old. But I like they have a different view on life. And to be honest, our kids are depressed and they're anxious and they are not satisfied with themselves. Why? Because they spend the majority of their time on a device that tells them they're not pretty enough, they're not skinny enough, they don't have good enough clothes, and they don't have everything. You just fill in the dot, dot, dot. And guess what? We're not removed from that. Our generation is affected. All of the generations are affected. All right, so on any given day in the United States, teens enjoy about 9 hours a day for enjoyment on media. Okay, this is average. This is a pre-COVID study also. Tweens spend about 6 hours a day. I think the sheer volume of media technology that kids are exposed to on a daily basis is mind-boggling. It just shows you that these kids live in this massive 24/7 digital media technology world, and it's shaping every aspect of their life. They spend far more time with media technology than any other things in their life. This is the dominant intermediary in their life. Back when I was learning how to be a teacher, they said parents have the biggest say and then teachers. Guess what, parents? It's no longer you. It's media technology that is now shaping every aspect of our kids' life. Isn't that scary? It's very scary when you think about all the things. And maybe you guys are raising your children differently, or maybe your families are different, but does that give you a little bit of an eye-opening when you're interacting with people at the grocery store, when you're interacting with the public in general? This is what most people are living with, okay? And just in case you thought you were exempt, you're not. Sorry, the other arrow. And the other one? Chris, do you want to go back since you know what I'm saying and how I'm saying? Since he just heard me say this in Allegan, we might be in more seat. Okay, so go back one. Back. There we go. In case if you were wondering how you're doing, the average American adult is consuming 12 hours and 9 minutes a day. And this is also pre-COVID. Pre-COVID, I read studies that said that Americans are spending as much as 13 to 17 hours a day on media. Okay, that doesn't mean just your device. That means radio, TVs, DVRs, tablets, video games. It's the gamut. Okay, I'm not just talking about smartphones, just so you know, for that 12 hours and 9 minutes. That also includes the listening to the radio on the way to work. Okay, so to give you a little idea, if it's 17 hours a day, that's 44 years of your life out of a 60-year lifespan that you are spending looking at a screen. And this is the average American, okay? This is the average American. So if you're not spending that amount of time, what does that mean your neighbor's doing, right? Then they are spending that much more time. And I just think as Adventists who are very excited about our life last day message, we need to know the people that we're working with. And if we were completely honest and looked in the mirror, I think we'd be a little bit shocked about how much we spend on our devices on a daily basis too. I don't know if you know, but on your devices, it can tell you how much you spend a day. It might be worth tracking that and being like, oh, Poppernickel. It was really good. When I was in Arizona, I spent 1 minute a day on my phone. My phone was dead, but I did great. All right. Quality of life isn't measured only by what we gain, but also by what we trade for it. Technology is not all bad in any way, shape, or form. I mean, that's how I could keep in touch with my family when I was in Switzerland. There are lots of blessings to be had with technology. But we need to realize that there's also something that anytime you say yes to something, you're saying no to something else. And as long as you're aware of it, then you're making the choices. But too often, honestly, if you looked at your phone, you don't even know where the time went. You're like, oh, whoa, I just spent an hour on Facebook scrolling. How is that possible? Well, we're all guilty of spending a little bit too much time on a device that really doesn't give us anything profitable. What I see in America today is almost a religious zeal for the technological approach to every facet of life. It's a value system, a way of thinking, and it can become delusional. Think about our cars now have, you know, video players in the back of our seats so our kids can watch a movie so we don't have to have the backseat noise anymore. I mean, they now design baby things where you know, the baby lays on her back and she plays with little things. They now have a little slot for the phone to put in the phone. You go to any teacher's convention, and they're always telling you, do this technological approach in your classroom, do this. And there's good in it, but it's like, and this is what the world is saying, that there's almost a religious zeal for the next, the best, right? The iPhone, I don't even know what we're on right now. I still have an iPhone 6, so I'm a little bit behind. But iPhone 12 Plus, or I don't know. It's just you always have to get the best next thing. All right, but that's it. Boo-hoo done. Okay, from here on out, it's for the beauty of the earth. Because by weighing the consequences of the disorder, we can also become aware of how blessed we can be biologically, cognitively, and spiritually through positive physical connection to nature. So you worry about your vitamin C. You worry about your vitamin D. From now on, I want you to worry about your vitamin N. How much nature exposure did you get this past week? How much nature exposure are you putting in your calendar for next week? And our model is Jesus. And Jesus' education was gained from heaven-appointed sources, from useful work, from the study of the scriptures, from nature, and from the experiences of life, God's lesson books, full of instruction to all who bring to them the willing hand, the seeing eye, and the understanding heart. Apart from the unholy ways of the world, he gathered stores of scientific knowledge from nature. He studied the life of plants and animals and the life of man. From his earliest years, he was possessed of one purpose. He lived to bless others. For this, he found resources in nature. New ideas of ways and means flashed into his mind as he studied plant life and animal life. So if Jesus is using nature to understand his Father, how much more should we be using nature to understand our Father, right? And Jesus created these things, but yet he studied them. And as he studied how different scientific processes went, then he was saying, ah, now I understand the love of my Father. So I'm going to show you five reasons that you need to spend time in nature. So how many of you guys want to be mentally stimulated? You feel like your brain is just not clocking along how you want it to be. Okay, emotional well-being, are you feeling stressed, anxious, depressed? Creativity, you wish you had a little bit more creative things running through you? Physical, so mentally stimulating, we'll start with that one. All right, so let's start simple. You don't live in nature, you don't live in the great wilderness, just look at it. Better and think more clearly. So they did a study on 1,200 state and office workers, and they found that just looking at it was the key. Where those with a window view of trees, bushes, or large lawns experienced significantly less work frustration and more work enthusiasm than without such views. So you want to get excited about going to work? Look at nature. You want your kids to be excited? Look at nature. So rearrange your houses. Can your dining room table face a window? Can your kids' bed face a window? Simply by looking that you get it. All right. So they know that we have psychological wear and tear. That's life, right? Life is going to wear you down. You can't avoid that. But they find that there's these two attentions. There's directed attention, and there's attention because you're curious. You're just like, whoa, what's that? And too often, we spend all of our time in directed attention. So right now, you're directed attention. You're just having to focus on one thing, right? And we all have to do directed attention, and it's not bad. Like reading a book is directed attention. So they did a study where they had 40 minutes of directed attention on a sequence of tasks. And they're like, all right, let's see how we can have them go do something and come back and perform again and perform better. So they had them randomly assigned to 40 minutes of walking in a local nature preserve, walking in an urban area, or sitting quietly while reading magazines or listening to music. None of these sound like bad options to decompress after you've been working on something. What did they find gave the best result? Well, I'm sure you know the answer. Otherwise, why would I be up here, right? Walking in the nature preserve. They found that they performed better than all the other participants on a standard proof reading task. So if you get nothing else from this, just go outside every once in a while and give your brain a chance to decompress. Life has a lot getting thrown at you. Give yourself a chance. You know, honestly, I believe this message is for such a time as this because it wasn't needed 20 years ago. If you talk to your parents or your grandparents, they had memories outside, right? They went and played in the yard, or they made an old abandoned lot a baseball field. It was just the way of life. But if you ask our kids or just watch our kids today, what do? They come home and they get on a screen, or they play video games, or they watch a movie. Hard, to be honest, to be interested in what's out there when changes like this. It's boring to go out there. You have to give yourself time to adjust to a different tempo. All right, in these lessons direct from nature, there is a simplicity and purity that makes them the highest value. All need the teaching to be derived from this source. In itself, the beauty of nature leads the soul away from sin and worldly attractions and towards purity, peace, and God. Too often, the minds of students are occupied with men's theories and speculations, falsely called science and philosophy. They need to be brought into close contact with nature. Let everything which their eyes see or their hands handle be made a lesson in character building. Thus, I love God because all of his biddings are enablings and all of his commands are actually promises of something better. You've seen that little picture. I'm sure it's been around quite a bit, but Jesus is kneeling down in front of a little girl and the little girl is holding onto her teddy bear and Jesus is holding his hand out and then one hand is behind his back and he has a massive teddy bear. But the little girl's like, no. And I think too often we're like, no, this is my way of life. This is what I'm comfortable with. I like this. And God's like, but I have something better. Something better. Please give me a chance. All right, emotional well-being. Results of a sedentary lifestyle is simple. Kids get depressed. The rate at which American children are prescribed antidepressants almost doubled in 5 years. The steepest increase was 66% in American preschool children. That is who is now being prescribed antidepressants. And believe it or not, that started back in 2008. Okay, so imagine what it is now. So if nothing else, over 100 studies confirm that one of the main benefits of spending time in nature is stress reduction. So do we have kids that are out of the church? Do we have family members? Do we have loved ones? Do we have friends? Well, simply by taking them for a walk outside, you don't even have to talk about God, but his spirit is present there. And he will minister. You could take an atheist outside. They don't have to believe in God, but there's still the benefits. You know that verse that says the sun rains down on the good and the evil? It's because God allows nature for anybody and everybody. Even if you live in a city, you can look up at the sky. Even if you live in a city, you can see weeds that are cracking through a sidewalk, right? God put his methods of their healing right outside for us. Also, another thing, really allow you to talk anymore and touch. And we don't really touch anymore. None of the new communication technologies involve human touch. They all tend to place us one step removed from direct experience. So they did a study. This is really sad, but they did a study on babies back in the 1900s. Maybe you heard this study. But they didn't touch the babies. They wanted to see if that really mattered. They made sure the babies were always properly fed. They were clean. Their diapers were changed, but they never touched them. They had to stop the study halfway through because the babies were dying. We need human touch. I know we live in a world, especially now, where we have to be careful, and I understand that, but then touch your family more. Do you know the average person to be healthy needs 12 to 15 hugs a day? You need physical touch. We're designed for physical touch. So let's put that back in society. God has surrounded us with nature's beautiful scenery to attract and interest the mind. It is his design that we should associate the glories of nature with character. If we faithfully study the book of nature, we shall find it a fruitful source for contemplating the infinite love and power of God. In his lessons, there was something to interest every mind, to appeal to every heart. Thus, the daily task, instead of being a mere round of toil, bereft of higher thoughts, was brightened and uplifted by constant reminders of the spiritual and the unseen. And you can just stay here. I'll just go like this when you can change it. That way you're not ahead. This has a remarkable day-to-day life because there's a promise there. instead of it being a mere round of toil, brightened by constant reminders of the spiritual and unseen. Go back, please. Okay? And so, for example, when you look at the way Jesus taught, Jesus was always using things that people saw on a daily basis, right? They saw the farmer going out to sow the seed. They saw the birds. They saw the shepherd. They saw the mustard seed, right? He wanted to use things that they interacted with. But too often, we put spirituality on Sabbath, and we don't necessarily know how to carry it through our daily tasks, right? Well, I have found with nature that I can do this because what I use is look in your Bibles right now, and how many of you guys have a concordance in the back of your Bible? You guys have a concordance? I love my concordance. If you don't have a concordance, have no fear. There is a place for technology. I'm not trying to preach no technology, but if you download, I love it. It's the Blue Letter Bible, and it has the Greek and the Hebrew in it too, which has been really fun. But you have a concordance right there on your phone, or I have my favorite book ever, is a giant book about this big called the Strong's Concordance. I think you have to be strong to move it too. Ask my father. I get moved too much, and he loves moving all my books. Actually, he hates it. yeah, I have a lot of books. But the Strong's Concordance is awesome. And so one day, I was like, I want to live this. I want to see constant reminders of the spiritual and the unseen. And so I was like, let's start with clouds. Everybody sees clouds. You see clouds almost every day. So I looked up clouds in my concordance, and it was so exciting. So if you go to Hebrews 12, 1 and 2, Hebrews 12, and it says, therefore we are also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So every time I see clouds, you know what I can say to myself? Jesus is the author and the finisher of my faith. And I started studying clouds more because I was curious what else I could learn from clouds. Well, guess what? All through Scripture, God used clouds. So think about God and the Israelites, right? In order to represent his presence, because that was the whole point of God calling the Israelites out of Egypt, is he wanted his people to be a light to the whole world, was during the day he used a cloud to cover them by day and a pillar of fire by night. And then to represent when the Israelites were finally like done and they set up their tabernacle, remember the cloud came and rested on top of the tabernacle to represent that God was now dwelling with his people, right? They had built him a permanent dwelling to be with his people. Okay, so that's one example of clouds, but then keep taking it to the end of times. And what's the promise that we live with? We will be caught up together to meet our Savior in a cloud. Jesus is the author and the finisher of my faith. For the joy that was set before him and the joy that is set before me, despite whatever the world is going to throw at me, whatever the media, whatever Satan is going to try to destroy and discourage me, I can live with a promise every time I look up and see a cloud. Amen. Okay, creativity. So you want some creativity in your life. These next two are some really fun stories. So Benjamin Franklin, known to be quite a creative fella, right? He lived a block from Boston Harbor, living near water. I was much in and about it. At age 9, he was flying a kite from the bank of Mill Pond, a holding area for water from high tide. It was warm, so he wanted to go for a swim. Reluctant to leave the water, but wanted to fly his kite. Pondered his dilemma until it occurred to him that he need not forgo one diversion for the other. Climbing out of the pond, Ben untied the kite and returned to the cool water. As the buoyancy of the water diminished gravity's hold on his feet, first wakeboarder, Mr. Gehring, he felt the kite tugging him forward. He surrendered to the wind's power, lying on his back and letting the kite pull him clear across the pond without the least fatigue and with the greatest pleasure imaginable. There is something, if you guys remember, when you grew up as kids and you played outside, you got very creative, Ask my little brother, Ronnie. He tried to be monkey many, many, many times as he tied ropes from one tree to another tree. Sure, he could make it across on bale of twine. But there's something about when you have little and nature that you just become more creative, because how does that little saying go? Necessity is the mother of invention, right? And there's something about being outside that you're like, well, how am I going to make this happen? Well, let me tell you, on media, you don't have to figure things out. You're just getting a great story and you're being entertained. So you're not problem solving. And if you notice with our kids, when I was teaching at high school, I just was amazed at the lack of ability to problem solve. It just wasn't a taught or learned skill anymore, because if you're not in a place where you have to problem solve, how would you learn to problem solve, right? It's about being put in those situations constantly where you're like, wait, how does this work? Wait, how does this work? But media, you don't have to figure out how it works. Well, you have to figure out how your screen works, and that's about it, right? Okay, Thomas Edison, another cute story. He was 4 years old, wandered away one day while visiting his sister's farm. He was found sitting in a box of straw. I saw baby chickens come out of eggs the old hen was sitting on, so I thought I could make little gooses come out of the goose eggs if I sat on them. If the hens and geese can do it, why can't I? And this is a golden teacher right here, the big sister. It's all right, Al. If no one ever tried anything, even what some folks say is impossible, and was he not always trying to conquer the impossible? Oh yeah, by the way, Benjamin Franklin, that little obsession with kite, do you remember what happened later in life with him and kites? And keys and electricity? So that whole love of kites at a young age kind of carried him to lots of inventions later in life. Well, Thomas Edison, no one will ever learn anything. So you just keep on trying, and maybe someday you'll try something that will work. And he's the one, when he was inventing the light bulb, his coworkers were like, we've tried this 1,000 times. This isn't going to work. And he's like, but I found 1,000 things that won't work. I mean, come on, last time when you tried 2 or 3 things, you're like, forget it, let alone 1,000 things. But there is something about being. Contemporary urban poets have moved away from Wordsworth and the Romantics, whose metaphors were shaped by sublime natural forces, whose rhythms were so often set by the cycles of nature. The newer language of art emanates from the human built environment, from the street, from computers. So just look at modern art, right? It's changed because we're developing art in different places. This urban or electronic expression of a creativity speaks to and for modern eyes and ears. That's why, you know, your teens are loving music and you're like, huh, that's music? Well, it's because it speaks to modern eyes and ears, what they're used to, what is their metaphors and what's their rhythms, right? Creative people who came of age in the 1970s, rock songs among them, seldom describe inspirational childhood experiences in nature. So it seems creativity occurs without natural influences, but it may have a different tempo. So you're going to be creative. We were designed in the image of God, right? And he is a creator. So we are creative. But if we're always allowing man to help us be creative, whether that's on computers or on a screen or in 4 white walls, then it's going to have a different tempo naturally, right? So let's try taking our church board meetings and do them outside. Let's try doing our school board meetings outside. Let's try doing our family meetings outside. What if our conferences, when they were making new initiatives, they met outside instead of indoors? Not because they're looking for something to be like nature, but because simply allowing yourself to be outside, you're going to have different ideas of what creativity is. Does that make sense? Pretty exciting, I think, and pretty awesome. So let's see what ideas we come up with in the next couple weeks. All right, physical health. Pediatricians now warn that today's children may be the first generation of Americans since World War II to die at an earlier age than their parents. Inactivity is seen as a major risk factor in non-communicable diseases, which cause 60% of global deaths and 47% of the burden of disease. So if companies wanted to help their insurance rates go down, they should just start a get outside program. Go time. Get outdoors. Geo? Yeah. I love it. The World Health Organization warns that the sedentary lifestyle is also a global public health problem. So believe it or not, but sitting is now called the new smoking. They're saying that sitting has just as much detrimental effects on your body as smoking. So everybody stand up, right? Stand up. I know it's hard. You feel comfortable, but stand up, because I don't want to be the cause of like damage to your body, physical health right now, right? So stand up, allow yourself to stand up, because sitting for too long is detrimental to your health. So question yourself while you're standing, how much do you sit in a week? How much do you sit every day? it is not very healthy. Okay. Feels good to stand up. Now you may sit back down. All right. Blood pressure simply by watching fish in an aquarium. So next time you're at your docks, what did you do to your diet? What pill are you taking? No, I'm not taking my blood depression. I'm not telling anybody to get off medicines. Well, definitely not a doctor. So do it in the doctor's prescription. But you can lower your blood pressure simply by watching fish in an aquarium. All right, so we should all be getting fishes in our fish in our rooms, in our kids' bedroom, in our classrooms, in our business offices. Also, there's a link between pet ownership and lowering of high blood pressure and improved survival after heart attacks. There is an approval about having a dog. And for those of you who have an indoor animal, I'm sure you recognize that bond with, I know I grew up on a farm and animals were great, but when my dog moved in with me, I have to say the level of bond when you're in with that dog all the time is very close. No, he was not allowed to sleep with my bed. All right. Many studies credit exposure to plants or nature with speeding up recovery time from injury. A 10-year study of gallbladder surgery patients comparing those who recovered in rooms facing a grove of trees to those in rooms with a view of brick wall, the patients with a view of trees went home sooner. So next time you're in the hospital, ask for a view of trees, and you will get to go home sooner. And if you can't, get this. I've done some research and study into it, and just looking at nature actually gives you almost just as many benefits. So ask your family to bring in a calendar of nature and look through the calendar of nature. Put a poster up in your hospital room of nature. Or get this, even looking at your phone and watching nature videos can have some of the same effects. Isn't that incredible? God's like, all right, I'm going to work through whatever avenue I possibly can to reach you because I want you to have something better. I don't want you to be discouraged and overwhelmed by all the problems of this world. I want you to live with joy and hope in your hearts every day. Research revealed Michigan prison inmates whose cells faced a prison courtyard had 24% more illnesses than those whose cells had a view of farmland. Even people in prison are having proof that looking at nature is beneficial. People who watch images of natural landscape after a stressful experience calm markedly in only 5 minutes. Their muscle tension, pulse, and skin conductance readings plummet. So try this. So, you know, Chris and I are learning how to work together, all that fun thing. And, you know, sometimes tension's a little high as you learn to work together. So next time you're in the heat of an argument, did you know that your brain is unable to think logically when you're angry? It stops part of you, and you're not able to use part of your brain to think logically because your blood pressure is up. When your blood pressure is up, you're not able to logically reason through things. So when you're in the middle of the heat of the argument or the tension, or you have a student in your classroom who's just really frustrated, let them go outside for 5 minutes and then either go out there and join them and retalk about the argument or come inside and talk about it. Just try it as an experiment. Next time, I know that probably none of you guys fight with your spouses or anybody in your home, but if there ever is any tension, then try it and see what happens after just 5 minutes of going outside and then re-look at it. It's been amazing how differently we approach our difficulties when we like, okay, I'm upset, I'm stressed, let's go out and then come back in. With us, we've noticed just looking at it doesn't always help, we just need to get out. So try it. All right, institutions for the care of the sick would be far more successful if they could be established away from the cities. And so far as possible, all who are seeking to recover health should place themselves amid country surroundings where they can have the benefit of outdoor life. Nature is God's physician. The pure air, the glad sunshine, the flowers and trees, the orchards and vineyards, and outdoor exercise amid these surroundings are health-giving, life-giving. Physicians and nurses should encourage their patients to be much in the open air. Outdoor life is the only remedy that many invalids need. It has a wonderful power to heal diseases caused by the excitements and excesses of fashionable life and a life that weakens and destroys the powers of body, mind, and soul. Ministry of Healing. And you know, Ellen White gave us this counsel over 100 years ago. And what I love about it is the more I study science, it just backs up all the counsel that has been given to us for 100 years. That the trends out there is actually to get out more. Public schools are trying to start garden programs. There is a secular movement talking about getting off screens and getting outside. But we've had the counsel for generations and generations. And yet, I don't think we as a church are living any differently than the world, because guess what? They've created the phones to be addicting. They literally studied it psychologically. They made the ding. When the ding goes off, that actually releases a happy hormone in your brain that says, ooh, somebody likes me. That makes me feel good. And so you have to go check your phone. And so literally, we don't war against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, right? And in it, God gives us a way out to combat whatever addictions that we have. Time in nature is not leisure time. It's an essential investment in our health and in our children's health. So there is connection with my Savior, with my best friend. And so nature presents the young with something so much greater than they are. It offers an environment where they can easily contemplate infinity and eternity. We cannot care for God if we do not care for creation. The extent that we separate our children from creation is the extent to which we separate them from the Creator, from God. And doesn't that make sense, that the devil, I'm going to use something that could be incredibly life-giving, technology, you know, getting the good news, the gospel to the whole world, the ends of the world, right? There's things that we can do now that we never could have done 10, 20 years ago. But I'm also going to make sure that it separates them from their Creator. We don't often talk about this, and I think maybe we should a little bit more, but in Genesis 3 and the garden, what was the first command really given to Adam? We were given dominion over the earth. We are caretakers of the earth and its resources and the plants and the animals. And I think it's time that we study and realize that we each leave carbon footprints. Sure, the dollar store is only things for a dollar, but do we realize how many energy and resources go into making that $1 item? Do we really need it? Should we consider buying more things at thrift stores? Should we consider plastic and recycling? Because we make an impact on this world. And even though the items might be really cheap and convenient for us to get, someone somewhere worked hard. Did you know that if everybody was a vegetarian, that there actually wouldn't be starvation, there wouldn't be world hunger in this world anymore? Because of the fact that it takes so much resources to feed cows, and all of those fields and everything is being used to get to feed cows, and then out of the cows, the amount of food being eaten is very small compared to how much of a field it took to feed the cow, all right? And it's not just vegetarians. Choosing to eat dairy and enjoying dairy, that also takes a huge toll. And all of us love our dairy, right? Our cheese and our milk. And so all of us, we can go to extremes and say, oh, if I'm vegetarian, then I'm taking care of the world. Well, look into veganism and look into how much milk and cheese has an effect. Or look into your clothes. And how much, do you know how much water it takes to make one shirt? Gallons and gallons and gallons. So nobody is exempt from this. It's just being aware that your choices cost something somewhere else. All right, the purpose of creation really is to bring us closer to the Creator. As a parent, you don't encourage children to experience nature because it's pretty, but because your children are exposed to something larger and longer standing than their immediate human existence. Isn't that awesome? I think that's so awesome. All right, and the last one. Many illustrations from nature are used by the Bible writers, and as we observe the things of the natural world, we shall be enabled under the guiding of the Holy Spirit more fully to understand the lessons of God's word. So are there things about God's word that is confusing to you? Are there things about God's character that is confusing? Guess what? In the natural world, God has placed in the hands of the children of men the key to unlock the treasure house of his word. The unseen is illustrated by the seen. Divine wisdom, eternal truth, infinite grace are understood by the things that God has made. Child guidance. So how many of you guys carry around keys with you? You guys carry around keys? Well, every time you pull out the key, you could say to yourself, that nature is the key to unlock the treasure house of his word. How awesome is that? And we all carry around keys. I think that's the way that God wants us to walk. To walk with him means to think of his words and not our words, not me trying to constantly tell myself, okay, I will be kinder. I will be more understanding. I am dying, right? And when I equate things in nature to God, then I'm living on his words and not my words. So take some time this afternoon, take some time this next week to find things in nature that you see all the time, and what promises can you equate that to? So grass, you know, the grass fades and the flower withers, but the word of God endures forever. I've always had such a problem memorizing scripture. I went to all the fun breakouts, how to learn scripture. Remember, you know, like get the cute little 3x5 cards. I could never do it. But since I've just started doing it practically on things that I see every day, I can say so many verses. Now I get stage fright, so I get nervous that I need it now. But I have just found that as it just relates to my life and my real life and my struggles, that I get to live on God's word. And I found a quote in SDA commentary a couple of years ago, and I think it's awesome. It says, "The Christian's sense of security grows out of confidence in the promises of God and personal experiences in which those promises have been realized." So do you want security in your Christian walk with God? It's personal experiences in which those promises become your promises. So years ago, I started writing in my Bible, I have places, I have events, I have people's names, I have nature. And if anyone ever asked me to get up and preach a sermon or do a Vespers, I'd always have something to say because this Bible is my story. It's combined of my life. And I started back in 2010. And so there's canoe trips, there's lost glasses, there's kids that, ooh, I love. And all sorts of wonderful things and stories where these promises have become mine. And, you know, often when we think of God's promises, we're like Jeremiah 29:11, you know, "For I know the plans I have for you, plans for the future." And we know that promise. And we know Proverbs 3:5-6, "Trust the Lord with all your heart." But do you know there's thousands of other ones? Thousands of other ones. So look up things in nature in your concordance. Or another thing I do is sometimes I just use a word in my concordance that I'm just longing for. Chris and I in the last week have been studying grace. For our week word. And so on Tuesday, we were doing a training for the village teachers down at this little place called This Is Our Daily Bread in Marcellus, just like 40 minutes down the road from here. And on Tuesday morning, we woke up and it was really foggy. It was like really foggy. And I was like, this is so cool. Like it was the kind of fog that you saw go across the sky, like just that dense moving fog. Well, fog isn't in your Bible. But I still think that there's a key there to unlock the treasure houses of his word by understanding how fog works. And so I was like, well, I can't find fog in my Bible, but we're studying grace. So I'm just going to study about grace. So grace led me to Psalms 84:11. And this is where God is just, wow. I always make sure that you don't just read the one verse and stop there, because then you're making the Bible say what you want it to say, right? And often I find that the promise that I really needed, because God knows your heart, and every day we come with heart sores, right? We're overwhelmed, we're sad, we're discouraged. There's something that we need God to fill. And often I find that the promise I needed is somewhere else in that chapter. So I was reading Psalms 84, and I got to verse 11, and this time the nugget that I needed was in verse 11. And it says, "For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly." Well, how does fog work? How is fog broken? By the sun. I didn't even think about that when I was looking up. I was just looking up grace, which grace is in that verse, right? Now, the fog was dense, but the sun was shining at its same intensity that it shines every morning at 8 o'clock, right? The sun is always shining at the same intensity, the same energy, the same light is still coming out of it. It just happens that there was more clouds on the earth at that moment, right? And I can't understand God's will. I don't know why he allows some things and why he doesn't allow other things. I don't know. But I do know that I can trust him because he is my sun and my shield. There's an inscription written on a Jewish ghetto during the Holocaust, and it says, "I believe in the sun even when it's not shining. I believe in love even when I don't feel it. And I believe in God even when he is silent." And so right now, I have to admit, I feel like I live in a slight fog. Chris's visa officially expires November 13. And then what? I don't know. I'm not doing a typical teaching job. I was going to hit the road, but this might not be the best time to be hitting the road and traveling around, right? And so I feel like I'm living in this fog that I'm just not sure, God, what is my next step? But I don't necessarily have the fog cleared, but I have a promise that I've experienced, because the Lord is my sun and my shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. And if you look up at verse 7, it says they go from strength to strength. Well, I know it's a miracle that he got here in May. So therefore, I know if God took care of us in May, he's going to take care of us in November, right? And I'm sure each one of us can look back and see how God has led us in the past. You know, Ellen White says, we have nothing to fear for the future except for how God has led us in our past. And as I've written down all these wonderful stories of God providing, I see down here, Switzerland, Australia, leaving heritage, all these different stories. If God has done it from strength to strength, I'll keep moving, right? Even if I live in a fog. And so I just want to challenge you this afternoon, maybe somehow in our church services, we can start sharing the cool nature analogies that we've come up with. But let God speak to you this week and let him speak to you all throughout the day as you go outside. Because that's really the whole point. Yes, science says there's wonderful reasons to go outside. But who cares about any of that when I can just have my Savior know my heart and know what I need right now? Please stand with me as we sing 518 and sing it with a new understanding, standing on the promises of God.